So this is a panel on how concerned should we be with catastrophic risk. The main speakers on this panel will be Andrew Maynard and Shadow Hegarty, but we'll be joined, or we are already are joined, with the chairs and the speakers from this morning's special session. We will join in, and we will leave time as well for questions from the audience. You heard this morning the introductions of your chairs and your speakers of the earlier panel, so I will just briefly introduce Andrew Maynard, who is the director of the Risk Innovation Lab at ASU. He trained as a physicist and spent many years as a bench scientist before being seduced to the world of policy, transdisciplinary research, and science communication. His work focuses on innovative approaches to thinking about and acting on risk, of all things. And then our other main speaker to his left is Shadow Hegarty, who holds a PhD in computational biology. He is the executive director of the Center for Study of Existential Risk at Cambridge, which is one of our co-sponsors, particularly of this special session. Sean previously ran research programs on the impacts of future technology, with a particular focus on artificial intelligence at Oxford's Martin School. Now, to start off this discussion, in my lawyerly way, I'll talk about definitions. And why don't we then ask, what do we mean by catastrophic risk, and is there a difference, any meaningful difference between catastrophic risk and existential risk? And for instance, are we talking about risk to human life alone, or does what we're talking about also include fundamental changes to humanness, or even risk to fundamental human values? So why don't we start with Andrew and Sean to talk about what it is that we mean by risk, and then we'll come back and talk about assessment and weighing of risk to try to answer our question about how concerned we should be about catastrophic and existential risk. Oh, Andrew.
Great. Thanks, Stephen. This is working, isn't it? Yeah. So I'm so glad you asked that. I was thinking maybe you'll sort of dive straight in and ask, should we be worried about catastrophic risk? And of course, as the academic, I was going to say, yes, absolutely. Then I was going to follow it up by saying, but I have no idea what we're talking about. So to me, definitions are critical. And I would actually throw risk in there as well, because we've got to be clear about what we're talking about when we talk about risk. But you just look at catastrophic versus existential. Of course, when we're talking about existential risk, we're talking about a threat to existence. But so often, we don't specify what sort of existence we're talking about. Are we talking about the total elimination of the human race, so we have a future where humans don't exist? Are we talking about changes to what it means to be human? Is that existential risk just a change from what we consider to be the norm now to some sort of future? Does it extend to other species other than human? And I think if we're going to be talking about existential risk, we really need to pin that down. But then you contrast that with catastrophic risk. That's obviously very, very different, because catastrophic risk is looking at an extreme risk or extreme impacts, and that can be very localized. If you're in Syria at the moment, you could say that you're facing catastrophic risk because of war. If you're in a drought area, if you're in the middle of that drought, you're experiencing catastrophic risk. So there, I think we have to be very careful about the bounds that we draw around the areas that we're looking at and the consequences that we're looking at.
Sean.
So I agree with Andy that definitions are important. Before this panel, I went and I tried to look up what the definition of global catastrophic risk was, and I found a bunch of fairly vague definitions. I mean, Richard Posner has one, Nick Bostrom has one, various other places have one. I think when we talk about global catastrophic risk, we do mean something with a global reach, so that will affect all parts of the globe. We usually look at it from a human-centric point of view, so we look at risks that threaten a large loss of human life or, in Posner's words, threaten to overwhelm civilization. As far as existential risk, again, Nick Bostrom has a definition where he says it's human extinction or the permanent and drastic reduction of humanity's potential, if you will, which I guess one could define in terms of values and changes as well. But as I understand it, he's thinking about, you know, if we really screw up the planet in such a way that we can't really dig ourselves out. I guess we tend to look at it, or at least in starting off CSER, my understanding is that we're looking at the slightly reductionist view of very large risks that threaten the planet, looking at humans in the first instance. But, well, I'd be interested in hearing strengths and weaknesses of that. I mean, it's one of these funny things where on the one hand, it's just words, but on the other hand, it's quite important. So.
Yes, we lawyers tend to think that words are quite important. It's all we have. We can't build things or open doors. Andrew, did you want to respond before we go over to the...
No, apart from the fact to say I think we're on the same page here in terms of really sort of pinning down what we're talking about. And I think it's clear there is something important here. But it's also clear that we need to put boundaries around that important thing so we can have a reasoned discussion around it.
The panel, would anyone like to jump in here? Charlie, you look like you want to say something.
I'm clearly going to be speaking outside my area of competence, but I was wondering, you know, to what extent have human societies actually experienced the feelings of existential risk? And how did they react? And I haven't finished the argument yet on my notes, so I'll just come out with it. At the turn of the last century, Admiral Perry and Matthew Hansen met in the Greenland at the top of the world a group of native Inuits who had never seen anyone else, a small tribal group of a few hundred, and had no cultural memory whatsoever of any other people. In fact, they called themselves the people. And I submit that their life was so precarious that they faced existential risk as a society every day. So then there's another cultural memory that came to mind of catastrophic risk, and that's the Black Plague that proceeded from basically Central Asia to Turkey, throughout Europe, and finally to the UK. In the years 1348 to about 1352. And wherever it went, there was a 50% mortality. And so it's, I think, very instructive to see how society reacted to that. And there's some interesting studies on the social reaction to it. So I think in these ideas are not all that new. But what is new is the fact that our entire global civilization and perhaps, and also our environment, are under a threat that we can perceive.
Anyone else from the panel want to talk about?
So responding briefly to the question of like whether it would be an existential risk if humans are eventually like replaced by machines in some way, I think that depends on sort of the kind of values that these machines end up having. And I think we could potentially see a scenario where, like, let's say humans merge with machines and become sort of very different, but sort of the core human values are still preserved. And then I would say that's not necessarily an existential risk, but that's definitely like a corner case that I think is not very clear.
Andrew.
So something that does fascinate me here is what we mean when we talk about risk. So this has been a little bit alluded to, that maybe we're thinking about the extreme of humanity ceasing. So there being nothing that we would call humanity. And yet, when you think about what we mean by risk, risk is essentially the probability of something bad happening. And you can slot into that sort of bad sort of box, whatever you want. And it's very human-centric to think about the worst thing that can happen is for humanity to end. But I think we also have to think about risks to culture and sense of identity. So is it an existential risk if we discover that in 100 years' time, we will still be living comfortable, happy lives, but we won't have any agency? There will be probably more than 100 years, but say we have a society where artificial systems are making all the critical decisions for us and we're just living a life of luxury. Is that an existential risk because it takes something away from what we consider to be fundamental to being human at the moment?
Rao. Yeah, I think that's something that I was also going to bring up in terms of should the life end for it to be existential risk, or should just the notion of how humans live. I don't know how many of you have seen the movie WALL-E, the robot basically taking care of the world that we have destroyed, and we are all fine up there, apparently nicely, you know, on steroids or whatever. And so the question is that considered existential risk? And in fact, when I give a talk to undergrads to get them motivated about AI, I call that, the title of that is Winding Our Way Down to WALL-E. And so in some sense, AI systems, when they're becoming very effective, they reduce it to some extent human competences. Already my kid cannot tell analog time, which I believe is extremely important to be human, and you know he can't tell. But I know there's so many of these things we no longer do. The question is that existential risk? You know, I guess probably not. It's just a cultural change.
Any, yes, sure.
I feel like this is a boring point, but it is, I don't want to use the word risk because we're talking about risk, but there is a pitfall to expanding the definition of something we're talking about to include everything we consider to be important, just in that it becomes very hard to know what we're actually talking about. I don't dispute for a second the importance of some of the issues that Andy's raised and that Subaru's raised. However, calling all of those things existential risk doesn't necessarily make it so easy for us to actually know what we're talking about and make progress. I would argue that perhaps we should have different terms for these things, just so that, I mean, recognizing the fact there is an existing research community that does this thing that involves, you know, nuclear winter and extreme climate change and pandemics and so on. I mean, that's just words again, but it does help to know what we're talking about.
Rao.
So I think already the words existential risk and catastrophic risk are typically used in the same sentence, and they mean completely different things. For example, I think we had global financial catastrophic risk issues where I think people just lost money. They're still alive. And you know, I think my point is that already there is this conflation of existential risk and anything, any risk of that can reach global proportions. Of, you know, and so I think it's not as simple as just saying that this is. And in fact, I would also argue that making a very specific point about existential risk involving essentially, you know, end of humanity as we know it might actually miss importance of catastrophic risks, you know, which might actually happen much more often on the way to before we get annihilated.
Yvonne and then Wendell.
Oh. So just a brief point on that whole, the whole problem with defining risk and defining what are warranted risks as opposed to unwarranted risks. And, you know, when you think about all the money and effort that was put into the Y2K problem or fear that it would be the end of everything, there were lock practices that were established and devoted to dealing with that particular risk, which never materialized. And you know, companies that had to be prepared for this catastrophe that at the end of the day turned out to be nothing. So.
Wendell and then Brad.
I think one of the confusions we're dealing with is it's the same it's the same technologies that could create these lesser risks that are also potentially creating these catastrophic or existential risks. So we may well be inventing the human species as we know it out of existence. That could be the course of the next few hundred years. That doesn't mean that something that carries the human genome will totally disappear from the planet. So the difficulty is it's those same technologies that could lead to a global pandemic that did eradicate the human species. And yet there's no evidence in our history, in any history that we know about, that there's been any global pandemic of that scale. So it's something catastrophic, but it's not necessarily an existential risk. Now that said, a true global pandemic could do worse in this society than the 5% of the world's population that was eliminated by the 1917 Spanish flu. But it's not necessarily an existential risk, it's more likely to be a catastrophic risk. And I think that's these difficulties we're getting into, is that an awful lot of these same technologies could create events that aren't going to eradicate the human species, but they could have be pretty traumatic if they occur.
So Brad, and then maybe we can go on to the next question since everyone will have spoken, unless there's a burning desire.
So I think it's interesting that in talking about all these risks, we haven't talked about the fact that the dystopian perspective that we bring to this is in itself a major risk, and that in spite of the fact that we have more people on the world living better than ever before, the entire discussion in this group has been about the terrible risks that we face, the existential risk, the dystopian. And I think part of that is because our major risk, unrecognized risk, nuclear war is a risk, asteroids are a risk, climate change is a risk, but our major unrecognized risk is human cognition. We're very poorly structured to function in a highly complex environment, and we tend to revert back to dystopian perspectives as a response. So in some ways, it seems to me that what we're seeing is the academic equivalent of Trump. And I find that unfortunate.
To be fair, this is a panel on existential risk. That's why we're talking about it.
I think I agree with the general perspective that we shouldn't only be focusing on the risks. And in particular with many of these technologies, like the reason that they are being developed is that there are very high benefits that the technology succeeds. So generally, I think we need to keep both the benefits and the risks in mind when we think about these technologies. And try to make sure that we develop them as wisely as possible and considerate of the risks while keeping an eye on the benefits that the technology is being developed for in the first place.
I want to move on. And, Charlie, did you want to?
I just wanted to add that I think in the climate change business, we turned a corner away from the identification of risk and attribution of its causes to a more practical issue of risk management.
So I want to now move from the definitional to asking about the assessment of risk. And I thought that Brad's point was a good segue to that in terms of human psychology and maybe even evolutionary psychology and the assessment of risk. I mean, are there features peculiar to human cognition and psychology that befuddle such assessments? Or anything else? Well, let's start again with our main panelists, Andrew, and unless someone else want to mute the microphone. We'll start with Andrew and Sean, and then we'll open up to the panel, and then we'll leave some time for the audience.
So the answer is, of course, there are attributes of us as organisms that dictate how we think about risk and how we respond to risk that are evolutionarily hardwired into us. I wouldn't say it's unique to us because we've got nothing to compare ourselves to. But certainly the way we think about risk, the way we weigh up evidence, and the way we make decisions, for all of us, it's based on mental shortcuts. It's based on what's hardwired into our minds. And under small, very specific circumstances, we can overcome that with rational modes of thinking, with logical modes of thinking. But by and large, we're still beholden to the way that we've actually evolved to work. So that has very specific consequences to both making sense of risk and responding to risk, no more so than when it comes to speculative future risks. So we're not too bad when something bad happens and we can retrospectively look at what caused that bad thing and we can put provisions in place to try and make sure it doesn't happen again. When we're looking to the future, we can intellectualize the future all we like, but we're still beholden to the mental shortcuts and the biases and the heuristics which dictate how we behave.
Sean.
I would agree and reinforce that. There's a growing and very interesting literature on the cognitive biases that come into play when we're thinking about risks, both in overestimating and underestimating. So, you know, we know that humans aren't very good at scope sensitivity, knowing the difference between 2,000 deaths and 200,000 deaths in a real sense. We know that there's something that in the insurance industry they call high watermark bias. We are used to the idea that a risk will be as bad as whatever the most serious version of that risk we've seen has been, but we're not so good at conceptualizing the one that's a lot bigger than that. I think these kind of factors become very interesting in the case of existential risk, in that we are required to conceptualize an event by definition we have never seen, and we have to prepare ahead of time to avoid an event that we have never seen. And I think that that's something that we struggle with both on an individual and an institutional way.
Andrew, I think, and then we'll go to the rest of the panel. Yeah.
So just to carry on with that thought, so this is the dilemma that we face. We're hardwired to think poorly about risk, and yet I would argue we have a strong responsibility to do our very best to ensure a future which is beneficial to not only ourselves but to future generations. So then the challenge is, how do we work within our limitations to do that? And there are obviously various approaches. One approach, which I think is very naive, is to bemoan the fact that some people, usually not ours, but other people are irrational thinkers, and try and convert them into rational thinkers, or in the words of somebody I heard recently, enable people to think like scientists. We know that that doesn't work. Instead, we've got to find methodologies that actually play to our abilities to think what you might term illogically, but I would say non-linearly, and actually use what we are to find those ways of making smart decisions now for the future and adapting to what we discover about the future as we move into it.
Why don't we just pass it down the, I'm sure everyone will have something to say rather than you.
Okay. So I guess the point is, I always knew that we humans are irrational, but I thought we researchers are supposed to be rational. But I guess I like...
That's just your biases.
I like the point that he made, that I think the sad part is, in some sense, as scientific disciplines trying to do disaster backchaining and saying the following thing can be happening, and so let's just see what we should be doing. Sometimes, I mean, I guess as scientific communities, we should be much more careful, in my view. I think that's some of the points I was trying to make, essentially. Not every imagined risk is real. Not every ignored risk is imaginary. And I think as scientists, we can't just say, Kahneman told me so I'm supposed to be irrational, so I get to be irrational. That makes no sense to me.
Okay. With many of these risks, it's just not even clear what's rational. So once every 100 million years or so, this planet gets hit by an asteroid equivalent to the size of the K2 event, which is often attributed to having led to the extinction of the dinosaurs, a species that dominated this planet much longer than we have. Now, it was 65 million years since that event, but given that it still might not happen for 35 million years more, I'm not sure how much on a statistical level, we should be worrying about it. On the other hand, we so misunderstand statistics that we fail to recognize that even though it might be millions of years before such an event occurs again, it actually might happen, if not tomorrow, within the next year or two. So is it irrational to be looking at that, particularly when we know ourselves as a species that we have a responsibility? Furthermore, if it could truly be an existential risk, shouldn't we be putting a lot of resources into ensuring that something like that, that could actually eradicate the species, should get attention? This is not the question on the table yet, but I think I'm going to put it on the table already, which is, how much attention should it be given? How much resources? I think many of us think it is important that we have some global preparedness for an asteroid hitting the Earth, but that still raises some fundamental questions about what the scale of that preparedness is. And some people would question whether we should have any preparedness at all, whether that's just a waste of money given the fact that it's very unlikely to occur, but in that it could eradicate our species and we have a responsibility to our species, perhaps we should give it some attention.
Thank you. So I was just going to follow up on the whole risk assessment and what Sean said about cognitive biases, and also the issue about media bias and private interest bias, which ends up skewing what is a true risk. And GMOs are a typical example of that, and the proliferation of internet news, and for most people not knowing what is true science and what is pseudoscience, and that is a huge impact on how a risk is properly assessed.
So I'm afraid I don't have a great deal to add to this. Just a couple of comments. The path to existential risk runs through a concatenation of catastrophic risks. So if you think about catastrophes for the moment and what we learn from them, we are hardwired. We have a system, what? A fight or flight reflex. It also raises the salience of long-term issues. So when a catastrophe occurs, the job of a group like us is to answer the question, when they ask you, what will you say?
So I would also like to follow up on Sean's point that when we are trying to address and make predictions about existential risks, then by definition, we don't have a lot of data and we have all these different biases that can get in the way of thinking rationally about these sorts of risks. And I think this makes it especially important that we have sort of an interdisciplinary and diverse effort in terms of addressing these risks. Like, for example, in the case of long-term AI risk, we need to bring together people from different fields with different sorts of assumptions and biases, like not just computer scientists, but mathematicians and philosophers and economists and so forth. And if we have sort of enough researchers working on these risks and addressing these problems with different assumptions and different perspectives and different biases, then hopefully at least some of them are going to be right.
Yeah, so I think 2 points. The first is, I think risk is a highly normative proposition no matter who says it. The kinds of things we're talking about, we're tending to objectify risk because most of us have scientific backgrounds, or at least we've absorbed it even if we're lawyers. And what you end up with is a logical positivist approach to life, which means you know what risk is. And I remember reading D.H. Lawrence back in college, Women in Love. I'm sure some of you remember the passage. And he talks about how happy the rabbits would be if all the humans disappeared. If you take a rabbit perspective, then existential risks that might affect humans, like AI, might in fact be a highly desirable kind of thing. So I think that in talking about these risks the way we are, we're reifying our subjective views and pretending that they're more objective than perhaps they are. The second point is, I want to go back to Charlie's point because I think that's a really good one. The question might better be, what is it we should do about it? If we assume, and this is an assumption I think that some people share to a greater or lesser extent, if we assume that the technologies we're talking about are powerful and weird enough so that we really don't have any idea what the future is going to look like, then I think the question is not necessarily can we hypothesize a number of possible risks, because anybody in this room could do it and we could come up with a great list and we'd scare each other to death. But the question might be, given that we don't know what's going to happen, what can we do to incent the evolution of more adaptive psychologies, more adaptive institutions, and more adaptive structures that exist over time that will help us to adjust to a future that is unknowable, but probably is going to have a lot of pretty significant risks in it, even if we have no idea what those risks may be a priori.
That's doable, and that's something that can be done that would add to the resilience of both our intellectual response and the social responses that would follow.
So just a couple of follow-up points there. First of all, on your point, Brad, I fully agree with that. Really, the only reasonable approach, it seems to me, is to actually think differently about risk and almost embrace risk. Rather than sitting here now working out how we can eliminate risk in the future, just accept the future is going to be risky. The only way we can avoid risk is to be dead. So instead, we need to work out how to navigate that risk till we get to where we want to be. And then the risk doesn't become the object of our focus, but the actual end goal and how to actually deal with things that come up as they come up. The other thing I want to get back to, though, is Victoria's point about bringing in very different perspectives on challenges, which I fully agree with and I think is absolutely essential. However, I don't think we've really cracked how to do that. So you look specifically at the issue of AI. And to me, that is a very opaque technology. And by opaque, I mean people within the AI community have got a deep understanding of their own specific area. They've got something of an understanding of how things to fit together within the community. Outside the AI community, I think there is very, very little understanding at all of the mechanics of AI and how that can potentially lead to, in this case, existential risks. So the opacity is people outside the community have to take on trust what they're told. And as a result of that, you have engagement with philosophers, with policy experts, with social scientists, who are talking about a technology that they fundamentally do not understand. And how do we get over that barrier so we can have informed conversations?
Sean?
I agree with Brad's point about adaptive mechanisms going forward. I'm not sure I agree that it has to be an either-or situation, that we should do this and therefore give up on any attempts at scientific and technological horizon scanning and foresight. My view is we should do both as part of a broader framework while recognizing that any type of foresight and technology is going to be an error-prone process. With regard to your proposal that we embrace risk, I'd like to know how that plays out with a case example. I mean, climate change, what does that mean that we do? Do we stop trying to understand the scientific basis of climate change? Do we stop trying to mitigate climate change? Do we go with adaptation instead? I mean, what do these words mean?
Thank you. So in my mind, it starts with the understanding that we live in a dynamic world. And dynamism means that there are going to be risks that arise to specific systems. And the last thing you can do is try and maintain stasis. It doesn't work. Instead, you've got to work out how to adapt. And the only way you can adapt successfully is to work out what is important to you individually, to your community, to society as a whole, and work out what you need to put in place to maintain what is important. So that's what I mean about embracing risk in terms of understanding that risk is a reality. If we want to sort of carry on either thriving or even surviving, we've got to accept there are going to be risks. And the last thing we can afford to do is try and squash those risks instead. We've got to work out how to ride them to get to where we think is important.
Raoul, you want to?
Yeah, so I want to respond to, or actually support your other worry that, at least in the case of AI, as I was pointing out, my own frustration is apparently it doesn't require any background at all in AI to worry about how AI is going to do major damage to us. Reed Hastings can do it. Anybody who just read a New York Times can do it. That has a major problem, and I think it's a specifically bigger problem because I guess if you see Ex Machina, apparently you're an AI expert, and that's sort of there are not that many movies about global warming. It doesn't somehow lend itself to great movies, I guess, so there is that problem for all issues, but AI in particular. I think one thing that can be done is to avoid echo chambers where people who are thinking alike get together and think more alike. And you know, I know that there are some good directions, the good things that are happening. I was, as I said, last month I was at Wendell's workshop. And I told Wendell before I went there that, look, you know, I'm a skeptic. And you know, you may not want to invite me. And he specifically wanted to get a bunch of skeptics there. And I think we had great time in terms of actually And also there were people from outside of AI, and I think they basically learned a little more about the technology, and we learned a little more about the policy concerns. I think this is a learning issue, and you know, the only thing we can do is design mechanisms which don't foster echo chambers, which actually make sure that people with wide variety of views actually get to speak. That's more or less what we did in the micro world for our panel, because I really wanted all three of us to speak rather than just, you know, specifically talk about one or, you know, one or two specific viewpoints. Thanks.
Hear, hear on all of that.
Now, if we were going to come back to the ultimate question of how concerned should we be about catastrophic risk, maybe we should ask how we should weigh the risks, however we've defined it, against the benefits of the activity that produced these risks, because that's how we can tell how to one make the decision and how concerned we should be. So, and maybe I could, with respect to that question, suggest, you don't have to talk about this, but it's something that, that I stole from Gary Marchant. One of his favorite examples is the questions that have arisen with the Large Hadron Collider that several scientists have said could present a risk of creating a black hole or zombie strangelets that could destroy the world or maybe the entire universe. And in fact, two lawsuits, were one in the United States and one in Europe, were filed against the starting of that collider, and they were both dismissed. So if we're, in terms of how do we weigh the cost benefits, maybe that's something you could talk to if you want. And also in terms of that weighing, I wonder if that is, there could be any questioning of whether the right approach is a purely consequential weighing of costs and benefits, or whether in some cases, at least, there's some deontology that should sneak in here. But with that, start with Sean this time, and then go to Andrew.
Sure. I think this is probably the hardest question of all of them, and I'm very much looking forward to tomorrow's session on CBA, which, Wendell, you're one of the ones speaking at it. Yeah.
That's this afternoon.
Oh, it's this afternoon. Well, I'm looking forward to it. And
even more.
I agree that, I mean, firstly, it's very hard to get an objective assessment when you're talking about high impact, low probability events, and it's very hard to get any sort of meaningful sense of benefits as well as risks. So I'd like to raise a different example just because I heard it mentioned earlier on today in George Post's talk, gain of function influenza research. I was at a conference on this that the Volkswagen Stiftung organized about 18 months ago, and there was a panel of three esteemed virologists, each with 2 decades of experience, and then another panel of 3 esteemed virologists with 2 decades of experience each. And they all, you know, the first panel stood up and said, talked about the benefits of this and said the risks were minimal. And then the second panel stood up and talked about the risks of this and said the benefits were minimal. Now, I have a PhD in genome evolution. That doesn't make me an expert in this, but it makes me at least able to follow the discussion. I had absolutely no idea what to make of it. First question that came up from the audience was a science journalist who said, I have to go and write about this. I have no idea what to make of this. Two people stood up and they gave their own risk-benefit analyses of this kind of research. The risk in terms of loss of life that the people with different views came up with differed by 7 orders of magnitude. So when you're talking about a difference that big, it's a really, really hard one. And it's one that we need to figure out how to make some sort of start on getting it right, because we can't just invoke the precautionary principle in a heavy-handed way. I mean, if we decide, for example, not to do gain-of-function influenza research, then we may be quashing a potential risk in the same way that we may be quashing a potential risk in AI by saying, let's not do any more AI. But we are also exposing ourselves, in the case of pandemic risk, to the very real risk that we know about, which is that natural influenza pandemics emerge at a regular rate and that they are always with us. And if this research does have this potential benefit, then we need to think seriously before we decide to shut that down. I mean, that's a risk in of itself. The same is definitely true with artificial intelligence. I mean, artificial intelligence will help us with so many of the global challenges that we face. We cannot clamp down in a heavy-handed way and say there is a speculative risk in the future that must make us stop any research that will give us these benefits. That's not an answer, it's only a starting point.
Back to Andrew.
So actually the gain of function example really exemplifies the challenge we have here. We're asking an impossible question. And there's no way to come up with a robust answer. Unfortunately, I think because of who we are, and especially academics and intellectuals, we play a game of trying to intellectualize this and come up with fantastic ways of answering an unanswerable question. And somehow we've got to get beyond that. And it's a little bit like, I think, is this your bag down here, Wendell? It's like us having a conference on discussing what's in Wendell's bag without asking Wendell. We can come up with some fantastical ways of working out what's in there, but it's all absolutely meaningless because nobody has the first idea. So somehow we've got to get away from this. So backtracking to the question of should we be worried about...
Question from the audience.
Megan's got a... So that I had the microphone, this to me is a dilemma because we are incredibly good with coming up with processes and procedures and incredibly bad at working out whether they have any meaning in them whatsoever. But this does bring me back to the question of should we be worried about catastrophic risks? And the answer there is, speaking as somebody that makes a living talking about risk, absolutely. The reality is everything we do is going to have consequences. Whether we're coming up with procedures to work out what to do or what not to do, that's going to have consequences. Whether we're looking at promoting new technologies or not promoting technologies, that is going to have consequences. But I would actually put another layer on top of that and say that there are a number of indicators that indicate that we're within such a complex system now, an interconnected system within the world. Effectively, what used to be geographical boundaries and disciplinary boundaries have dissolved, meaning that we're in such a complex system that it's very, very hard to predict the magnitude of the consequences of our actions. It's almost impossible to put provisions in place now to guide very predictively those consequences. About the only thing we can do is develop very sophisticated ways of responding very, very rapidly to small indications of where the future is going and have course corrections as we go along.
So going down the panel, then, unless there are any other burning questions right on point from the audience, we'll go through the panel, then we'll open it up to the audience.
So we keep putting this preamble onto our risk, catastrophic existential risk. We've raised the psychological question about whether we are maladapted to even think about risk. And I think in a certain sense, there's a convergence of all these different topics. First of all, it's an existential risk not only for this Inuit community, or I guess it may not have been an Inuit community, but it's an existential risk for anyone when it's going to be their death and the death of their families. So we have an existential risk going on in Syria right now. We have existential risks constantly going on all over the world. Secondly, let's think about this society for a moment. Healthcare costs are growing at roughly 6% a year. They're somewhere around 17% of GDP right now. They'll probably be closer to 20% by the end of the decade. That, in and of itself, could be an existential risk. It could single-handedly cause the collapse of this economy, and we all know that the collapse of this economy is the collapse of the world economy. And yet we're so risk-averse that nobody wants to reform healthcare. So I think we're getting into this kind of crazy world where it's not even about existential or catastrophic risk. It's about whether we have a sane relationship to risk in any way, shape, or form.
So I just have a minor point, and that's a very basic point, is when we talk about weighing risks against benefits, it's the basic question is, under what model should we weigh them? We have so many models, utilitarianism, consequentialism, precautionary principle, and do we change the model? Does the model adapt to the particular issue that we're considering? And is there a better model to use when assessing this risk versus the other? So to me, you know, the fundamental question is, what's the right model to assess risk?
I'm in the wonderful position of being able to agree with everything I've heard. However, I want to agree more with one thing that I heard, and that's what you said about it only makes sense to go ahead, make some decisions, and then see where you are. And so I was just going to suggest that in the climate area, the question of adaptive management of climate is going to be more difficult and strain our human psychology for a variety of reasons, mostly of time scale. But I'll start by saying that adaptive management is what you do when you know you have a problem. You define the problem in your value system. You know you have this problem, but you don't know how it'll unfold. So you do what makes sense in the present and then come back and take a look. Now that means, what is the time scale between the decision, the moment that you decide to act, and when you ask for a response from the system? And in the case of climate, it's going to be very difficult. And the reason is, there are two reasons for it. On the one hand, because of the long lifetime of CO2 in the atmosphere and the even longer time of the energy deposited in the ocean, it's quite likely that, in fact, it's known that if we make a decision tomorrow to stop breathing and not emit any CO2 whatsoever, it'll be 50 or 100 years before we notice the difference in the climate, because already much of what's going to happen in the future in terms of climate change is already built in from what we have done. And so the decision maker will not see the result of his or her actions. So we're doing adaptive management with a 50-year timescale. More than that, the things that raise interest and, if you will, alarm in the climate are the changes that we are seeing now and that will occur in the future, the more wildfires and so forth. These are all due to what we've already done in the past. There's nothing we can do to mitigate them. So the cycle of adaptive management, decide a little, test a little, decide a little more, test a little more, has to be integrated over a 50-year timescale. And the decision makers have to believe the forecast of something that will happen or may not in the future. That's the difficulty. But I don't see any other way of there's no absolutist way to deal with this problem.
So in response to the question of whether we should be worried about catastrophic risks or existential risks, I think a distinction needs to be made between being concerned and fear or panic. And in particular, these issues of technological risks, as has been pointed out, are very opaque and nuanced and often difficult to understand. And I think the way we want to respond to them is do a lot of research and analysis and thinking about the nuance while avoiding sort of rash actions in response to these risks, especially since, as Sean pointed out, you can have risk estimates that differ by orders of magnitude from each other. And so the question of whether it's worth worrying or doing something about these risks also depends on the different kind of things that we could consider doing in response to those risks. What kind of comes to mind in terms of options there is you either do a lot of research and analysis or maybe start regulating. And I think for a lot of these risks, kind of thinking about them deeply and doing research and analysis needs to come first, and regulation needs to be used sparingly.
So it seems to me that the real question is whether we're able to evolve and educate
our psychologies, our institutions, and our cultures to be able to continue to exist on a terraform planet in the Anthropocene. Climate change, what we do is we focus on individual issues that then become a focus for all of our inchoate concerns. Climate change clearly needs to be managed, but if you look at, say, climate change and some of the ways we're managing it, we're disrupting the nitrogen and phosphorus cycles to try to fix the carbon cycles. We're ignoring confirmation bias in the part of large parts of the population that are leading to an undermining of science as a source of truth. So as we start getting more and more into the postmodern age and you start undermining science, the question is, if you're not going to use science as the source of truth because we've undermined it, where are you going to go for truth? We're getting into questions that are all connected at such a deep level that the real question we have to ask ourselves is, are we still competent at living on a terraform planet? And the answer so far is clearly no. And I think that that's not necessarily a bad answer, because what that simply means is that all of us are essentially obsolete, our institutions are obsolete, but we have an opportunity because we understand that to try to do better. What we're failing to do is not to identify the problems. All of us, as I say, could sit around and identify problems all day long. What we're failing to do is to try to use those to educate ourselves to rise to another level in the way that we conceptualize, frame, and manage the problems, knowing that most of what we are working with, including our ethics, including our laws, including a lot of the ways that we view the world, are in fact contingent and are rendered contingent by the evolution of technology. And so the question to me is, can we begin to adapt to that world? And I think we can, but I think we only can once we perceive we've got a much larger problem than anything we've talked about so far.
Okay, it's your turn. Yes, ma'am.
Saying that we're still in the postmodern stage, we're definitely not in the postmodern stage, but the thinking is indeed still located within the postmodern stage, which is technologically illiterate. Postmodernism did great work philosophically and social-wise, especially in academics, but discounting science and discounting the effects of technology as being possible solutions is far amiss within the postmodernist rhetoric. Time is essential, to be sure, but what it seems to be missing is that while we know there needs to be models, and I love the phrase of adaptive management within this context, the models must depend on technology. Because if we're going to put out fires, which is said that it's absolutely weak enough, but that absolute was within the time frame of 50 years, exceeding that time frame of 50 years, it seems plausible that certainly emerging and speculative knowledge will be able to smother fires through some of the scary technologies that are, by Bostrom, concluded within the realms of existential risk, which I don't understand that term anyway, it's existential risk. But it's possible if we open our eyes to learning about the technologies and think more of a actionary solution to balancing and mitigating the issues we're arrived at by the pros and cons of the bioethicist and those that try to put it in a casket with a nail on it. Technology solves technology, and I think that ties into the scientific conclusion that even areas where we try to do something is going to smother out other possible needs like oxygen, et cetera, but that smothering of oxygen can cure fires.
Do you want to respond, or do we go to... Yes.
Mark Stahl, University of Ottawa. I just want to make a connection between something Yvonne said and the actual panel here. So Yvonne, you mentioned the Paul Ehrlich's predictions and the Club of Rome. And this was half a century ago, and then I listened to this. I just find it striking that this panel is looking for solutions to very complex issues, to multitude of risks. But the debate that happened half a century ago about population and consumption has kind of disappeared from that. Maybe it's because of technology conference, but why is, for example, degrowth as a solution not be part of a debate over huge risks, because the risks have something to do with the number of people on this planet, I think.
But it's declining. Population is declining in many areas of the world, and that could very well be a trend.
But maybe it's not declining fast enough. The other issue is consumption is also used to be a huge issue. And I just want you to mention that connection.
Right.
Charlie, I think I can comment a little bit on this based on how the Great Vatican Conference on Climate and Sustainability proceeded. We were a multidisciplinary group of both scientists and social scientists, and the conference was divided, into three phases. Phase number one was all of these great experts in each of these fields got out and laid what they thought were the, if you will, the catastrophic or existential risks that were presented in their fields. And we had a large collection of issues. Many of them have been mentioned here. And then at a certain point, Jeff Sachs got up and said, we have no right to be pessimistic. That's what he said. You guys are all, and gals are all worried because you cannot see the solution to these great problems within your discipline. But what you can see is the emergence of small solutions that could be scaled up and might actually have a positive effect on the problem of global sustainability. Went well beyond climate, but climate was embedded in much of the discussion. And so the second part of the conference was a detail to what do we see the solutions could be. And there were a number of those proposed. Mine was one. It's just a piece of the adaptation problem. And so we went through that for 2 or 3 days. And then at the end of that, they asked us the question, what are the chances that you can scale these solutions to the global level? And do you think that if you were completely optimistic, do you think that you would, that these collection of solutions have the potential of solving the sustainability problem? And the answer was no. And so this came out from the scientists and the social scientists. And so then the question was why? And what was it that was required? And eventually, it came down to a philosophical change in the way human beings view themselves. The first level of that was that we have to view our level of consumption differently, particularly in the Western world. Okay? That we have to change our attitudes about what we consume. But it got deeper than that until finally it came across as a prescription that we would not solve the sustainability problem until we also understood the social problem. The mantra might be, the society that cares for its people will also care for the environment. And so gradually we were looking for a revolution in human values that came down to a reframing of human beings' conceptions of their responsibilities to each other and to nature. And so it really was, at the end of the day, a philosophical change that we thought was required beyond each of the technophilic solutions that we were thinking about.
Sean, and then Rao.
So great answer, Charlie. To come give my own answer to Mark's point, population issues are something that we are working on at the center. Unfortunately, Simon, who's working on this, can't be here today because he doesn't fly on principle because of climate change. But
where's the risk benefit there?
Skype.
Well, we could have put a Skype screen up here and have them. That would have been very interesting. Anyway, and I agree with the point that population is dropping in places, and we know some of the solutions to population growth. In particular, education and empowerment of women plays a really big role. I agree with Mark's point, though, that this may not happen quickly enough. I think taking a leaf out of your book, population issues won't be happening in isolation. We will be facing the challenges of a large and growing population in the context of a world in which soil erosion will become more of a problem. Soil erosion may be made more severe by climate change. These are issues that we simply can't take in isolation anymore. Now, I guess I open myself up to the criticism of painting very specific scenarios, but I think there's credible reasons to think that these are things we do need to be worried about in the next 10, 20, 30 years, and that we can't just treat as individual isolated risks.
Rob.
Yeah, so actually, I'm not going to talk about existential risks part, but one of the comments that Charlie made of that sometimes the fact that there is no solution might be because you're looking at your own discipline and there may be solutions coming from outside. So I want to make a lot of people here happy by saying the liars might be the solution to, for example, the AI and software problems. So for example, the amount right now, there's a significant understanding in computer science as to how to verify software, but it's just too costly. So all the software, most of the software you use from Google and Facebook and all this stuff, just basically uses you as the testers. There is no actual failure. There's no actual consequence for. there's no actual consequence for. A misbehaving software. And I think this partly because even at the level of simple autonomy, without any intelligence thrown in, law is still more or less, as far as an outsider like me can see, is catching up in trying to insist on consequences. And I think when those are present, it would be more natural for both the researchers and the industries to take safety issues front and center, as against somebody saying, oh my God, if you don't take safety issues today, there would be existential risk in some indefinable future. I mean, it's strange. I come from India, and we don't have Goldberg, Osborne, the injury liars. And sometimes I think having them would have helped in some sense, because that's a way of ensuring that there are consequences for what you're doing. And if you put a bad product out, a bad product could be a software which actually leads to bad, outcomes. And, there should be some amount of consequences. And, we should be, I'm bringing up the Tesla stuff, there should have been hue and cry that Tesla was just updating itself with driverless, abilities. And everybody was more happily worried about existential risk than the fact that Elon Musk's cars can actually be doing lots of damage. And by the way, don't think it's actually cannot be converted into existential risk. You throw in humongous number of humans, we are extremely good at taking simple things and converting it into existential risk. There are people who are actually talking about how to hack a humongous number of Teslas so that they can all go and hit something. And before September 2001, you didn't think of planes as a way of bringing down buildings. And now we do. And it's because we are extremely good at it, right? And so I think basically the only thing that's stopping it in the case of Teslas are there just too few Teslas, and if there are lots of them and they're all autonomous and they can be hacked into, this is just simple software hacking, you can get into all sorts of interesting problems. And so to get ahead of that curve, people should start talking about consequences, and Elon Musk should be able to realize that there isn't enough money that he can pay off if there is actually a problem like this.
Andrew.
Have you thought about proposing that as a movie?
Which one?
Armies of Teslas attacking? That would be awesome.
Well, I mean, yeah.
He'll be optioning
so
it after.
Movies, one more of this cannot hurt.
So it strikes me listening to this conversation that we really may be better thinking about the journey rather than the destination. So talking about existential risk, we can't predict the future, but what we can do is think about our responsibility to move towards the future in the right way. And that gets back in part to comments that Megan made about the process, thinking about gain of function. But it particularly struck me talking about population and sustainable populations. If you were just thinking about the future, you could say the ideal future future is where we slash human population by, I don't know, 100%, 200%, whatever. And you could say, whatever it takes to get there, we will do. We can do that. It's easy to do that. The trouble is, there are morally really questionable ways to do it. And that brings us back to the question of how we go forwards, where our responsibility is, where our moral obligation is as individuals and as societies to make smart choices and deal with the consequences of those choices rather than trying to reach a specific endpoint.
So let's just take the population problem as one. I'm not even sure what the problem is anymore. Do we really want a larger population? Do we want a smaller population? Is it a problem that that we're seeing decrease in population growth in certain countries when we know that we're taxing resources? And what about our movie last night? Wasn't that movie about life extension? We're talking about radical life extension. We aren't just talking about extending a few years, though that movie was largely about extending a few years. But if we eradicate many of the reasons why people die, we may actually be talking about 120 years or 150 years. So what's the impact of that on the population question? I think the difficulty is that we are dealing with technologies that intersect with each other, that converge, that affect each other, that it's almost bewildering to even know how to think about most of these problems. And we're also all caught up in our own silos of understanding within which we are observing these problems or looking at each of these problems in isolation with each other. I'm not sure what the answer to that is, but I think what Andrew was just alluding to is really on point. I don't know that we're going to be able to solve the problems because it's not always clear to me what the problems are that we're trying to solve. Or the problems become very personal in terms of what certain individuals would like to live longer, regardless of what that means in terms of world population. So their problem may be different than my problem. But the simple point is we are in this midst of the bewildering possibility. We're in the midst of an era when technology is becoming the primary determinant of human destiny. And are we going to shape that? Can we shape that? And do we have anything to shape that with more than the processes and perhaps more importantly, the values in which we try and inculcate in those processes?
Yes.
I'm intrigued. For the last couple of days, I haven't heard anybody mention an institution that's been dealing with existential risk since the dawn of man, and that's religion. I'm the last person in the world that should be talking to this because I consider myself a religious person. But it seems to me, in sort of tacking on with what Charlie said about trying to work with the institutions that we have in place now. The Catholic Church, for instance, is good at creating rituals and things like that that seem to have deep meaning. Nobody's mentioned the papal encyclical on climate change, which could be a kind of I think is doing an article on the analysis of that encyclical. But is there anything that we could learn from religion, even though we might think that it isn't, has been maladapted and common until now, that would allow us to think in ways that we could deal with climate change and these other existential risks in a way that relates more to humanity?
Charlie.
Yeah, it was that conference that gave some of the scientific underpinning to the encyclical. So it was of high consequence what was said there. I think afterwards what we began to think was that it would be important to enlist the religious organizations, religious thinking, into the struggle about sustainability. And to that end, the Pope has decided to speak with other religious and spiritual leaders and to see if we can't add that dimension, the dimension, if you will, large, the dimension of human values, institutionalization of human values, structures through religion, We thought that that would be an important approach to the whole problem. And the scientific co-chair of that conference, my colleague Ramanathan, is now spending most of his time on that dimension and speaking a lot to religious groups of various types. I should add that the conference was led by two Hindus. There was no religious qualification to participate, and there was no religiously based prohibition on any topic in the discussion, including birth control.
Yes.
So I have a question about more boots on the ground risk management. In general, it seems like risks are fixed or bounded. Existential risk seems to almost by definition be infinite risk, or close to infinite risk. So given that, how do you, is there any way to then rationally come up with a way to price attempts to prevent such risk or to evade such risk, given that, you know, if you take any fixed positive probability times infinity, you get infinity, but clearly we're not going to spend all of our money to prevent any one or all of these risks.
I think actually that's one of my worries. And by the way, are you supposed to get it? One of my worries that you can pretty much say that any amount of work that you put in is not enough because there's infinite risk. By definition, it's infinite risk. And as much as we basically talk about, I think, for example, one of the favorite quotes now by Stuart Russell, for example, is like, you know, basically we weren't able to, we didn't work in time about the nuclear risk, nuclear bomb risk. But every risk that we have contemplated might happen, there were many, many other risks we contemplated will happen and didn't happen. And if we were actually busily working on all these infinitely costly risks with humongous amounts of effort, then this is basically decision theoretic foundations just completely fail you because, you know, I can always say you're not putting enough. I would personally say, let's say for the existential risk, if Nick Bostrom thinks about it, that's good enough for me. But right, but that may not be enough. You know, basically Nick can say, no, it's infinite amount of risk, so all of us should be thinking about it all the time. And he will still be right because of the mathematics will work out fine. And so it's a tricky issue of just, you know, pushing in that direction. And I kind of worry about, you know, talking about infinities in that form.
I feel like I have to defend this fairly unfair straw man of Nick. He's got a paper online called Pascal's Mugging where he specifically makes the point that you just made. Mm-hmm. I mean, he describes a situation in which, you know, I can't remember exactly how it goes, but it makes exactly this point that if we do the calculation, then it results in infinite resources going into existential risk every time, and that's just clearly silly. Yeah. I'm not sure I'd agree with only Nick Bostrom. I think maybe Elon Musk has got it right. He put $10 million into AI safety, a lot of which has gone to near-term stuff like transparency in neural networks, which is useful anyway. He put, let's say, $1 billion into OpenAI, an undisclosed sum into Vicarious, an undisclosed sum into Google DeepMind. So somewhere short of 1% of his philanthropic funding and investment has gone into safety. I think a 1% going into near and long-term safety is not exactly overly generous. I think it's worth having a little bit of perspective. We spent the day hearing about catastrophic risks, and so they're probably looming pretty large in our mind. We've met a lot of people who are working on these things. It's still a very small proportion of the global research community, a very, very small proportion. And an awful lot of the things that you would do to mitigate existential risks are the same actions that you might take to mitigate risks on a smaller scale. So, you know, some of the actions that you would take to avoid extreme climate change are the kinds of actions you would want to take to limit us to 1.5 degrees. Some of the actions you might want to take to mitigate an extreme pandemic outbreak are the same things that you would do for, you know, standard pandemic surveillance and antibiotic resistance and development of vaccines and so on.
Well, Okay, very quickly, because I'm told we have to stop.
I just want to disagree. There are lots of points, but I think I want to mention this one last point that you made, that lots of things that you would be doing to stop the existential risk are the things that you would be doing to stop the intermediate risk. That's unfortunately not at all true in the case of AI. In the case, I mean, you know, there's enough technical literature which basically may not do anything in terms of stopping existential risk, but will be extremely useful in the interim in making the existing system safe. I'm extremely in favor of that. I'm a little worried about the focus on the existential risk aspect. So if it is indeed the case that the same exact actions will wind up supporting both, I'm fine. But that's not true.
Well, we have to end this session all too soon. I want to thank Andrew and Sean and the rest of the panel and you in the audience. I'm sorry I couldn't get to more of your questions. And Gary is going to have something to say.